I've got this. This will work. There we go. You want to, you know the new schedule.
So we're, what we're going to do is spend some time leading up to lunch here, and I hope you've had a chance to check out the hotel if you were in it. And I'm talking about this last issue of research opportunities, and then apropos of wrapping up this conference, what perhaps are our action items. We're going to look ahead to lunch, and at lunchtime, Rick is going to share some more thoughts with us at lunchtime. Well, we're going to eat too. Rick is going to share some more thoughts. There'll be a presentation from some of our KU folks on potential funding for ideas that we have or opportunities for funding. And then the schedule says that we go to 3 o'clock, and we're just not going to do that. We're not going to go that long. But we are going to have a chance to talk about at least the action items that are emerging from the two workshops at the tail end of lunch. Okay, so if you you can still schedule whatever you had scheduled to do this afternoon, you might be able to do it a little bit sooner. We're not going to go until 3 o'clock. So turning to this list of questions that we had about research opportunities, yesterday one thing was clear. At one site, someone talked about, we have way more older people that want to volunteer to be mentors in my class than I can possibly handle. And also the expression that there are many organizations and businesses that want an affiliation with our teaching and want our research, would like that idea very much. So is it possible to take an opportunity to take advantage of that? I've seen myself the benefit of, for example, participant registries where names could be available to us for research purposes, for training students. I've needed them a lot in the past. And recently I've needed to find some people to do some things with, and also a diversity of people. So the possibility of having, we were thinking of a participant registry, or perhaps maintaining a network of research sites, and these could be places, but they could also be organizations. Do you at your universities or your places already maintain registries of older adults who are willing to participate in research? And what's the nature of those?
Yeah, I do. And it's only for research, it's not for service and other linkages, and it must be IRB approved studies that have come to me for the registry names.
So is yours just general people? I mean, not focused on
community-dwelling older adults. The only, I collect demographics for the registry, mm-hmm. but I purposely keep it relatively simple. The only thing I ask about is caregiving status, past, present.
There are registries, stroke registries and others, people with particular kinds of clinical situations, but yours is a very
general registry. It's for aging research that is put forward by either graduate students or faculty at my university, but I could collaborate as a collection site with someone else doing a study, and I could see the registry being used for that.
So that's the idea I think that some of us were talking about, is that in some cases you may be looking to expand the diversity of your participant pool. In other cases, you may be looking for people in a particular circumstance. Maybe though David was looking for people who were transitioning from a single family home into some other kind of housing. It's hard to find them anymore.
So
at
the Med Center, Keyes Med Center, we have a couple different registries. Certainly have the Alzheimer's. Which has a cohort of folks who have been diagnosed with mild cognitive impairment and moderate to severe. In addition, we have the Pioneers database that has many thousands of people that can be accessed, I believe, for a fee. And then,
for a fee?
I'm sure, yeah. And then the third one that I know of, though there may, we also have a stroke registry. qualification is that they are not diagnosed with a cognitive impairment or other neurological disorders causing cognitive impairment. So they can have a cohort of many other medical issues. And then we have some lab space that's being renovated right now. And we're actually going to get a call in the next few months for people that want to be, that meet the criteria to become associates of the Center on Aging Geriatrics Research Faculty.
So what the ADRC has some protocols in place for access. Pioneers, I like you, I think there's a fee.
I think so.
And it can be a fairly steep fee.
What is that Pioneers? I don't understand. I've never heard of this.
It's through the GCRC. It's a grant-funded research program.
So the Clinical Translations Center is sort of tied into that. I'm not quite sure how it all fits together, but I figure it's sort of part of that. Expansion.
Yeah, it's, Russ Wayman is here.
Yeah, he's I think he runs the
part of it.
I'm sure everyone knows about, the National Alzheimer's has the clinical trials that they're really trying to promote in a big way. One, to get people into it, but also to get researchers to use it. There's been a big push for
I've at various times had up to 500 people in the Lawrence community on a participant registry. Again, the kind of community dwelling, no real diagnosis of major neurological problem. I think the issues are whether how if people are willing to share access. And what kind of institutional review would be required? So, if I wanted to access yours, would I need to have IRB approval both from my institution and from your institution?
Yeah. Yes.
Because very few institutions have reciprocal agreements. We sort of do with the medical school, but even that doesn't really actually in practical affairs work very well. But so there, in many cases, would be issues of duplicate or multiple IRB approval. But that is just another administrative hurdle. Would there be others? We could sort of develop this on as part of the website as a posting of registries and rules for contacting and access and perhaps the profiles of who might put the demographics and the basic characteristics of the registry. There are others that
we have
ideas
that similar databases. Similar to the Greyhawk.
Would you be open to others? When Nicole is doing her dissertation on word finding problems of having her be able to have access to?
Well, that's really a conversation with Joan. So I can't speak for Joan, but I imagine she might be open to it.
And our policy will be that as associate of that sector, that's what we should access. I suspect that was to Joan used to run.
Yes. So there may need to be some way of vetting applications.
Does anyone know of ways to develop such a registry or database, or how do you get those 200 names or 500 names or ways to do this? I know you might develop them through a clinical population, identify them that way.
Yeah.
But community dwelling, just your generic community dwelling person over the age of X.
So we pull from the exercise boxes. We actually don't pull from clinical venues at all, from the programs that belong to the Center on Aging.
also recruit when we do outreach and through some of our community partners that deal with older adults from a wide variety of walks of life.
Yeah, I keep flyers with me all the time and hand them to whoever will take them.
Do you test it from time to time in the sense of send an email message to see if it's still, if this is still a good contact? Or...
Phone calls.
Pardon?
Yeah, I do phone calls with that population a lot of time.
Okay.
Takes a lot of
time. Yeah.
I used to send out periodic letters, newsletters, and the ones that came back were informative.
So given the difficulties of it isn't seamless access, you have to ask somebody, I would have to ask this person, I would have to ask this person, and there are IRB perhaps considerations. It doesn't sound like a unified registry could be created, seamless registry. But we could list registries.
We could list the
contact isn't if there are any qualifications on that registry.
I think building those seamless registries, like the Alzheimer's registries, is a lot more complicated. I mean, because in those cases, the issue of the confidential health information is in some sense part of the very nature of the registry, and that's much more complicated. So that this could be soon to particularly tied to student research and but also our own research efforts.
Yeah, at the moment I'm looking for people to pilot test a bunch of questions on their line of questioning, but I don't know how it's going to work. I really don't know how it's going to go. And I don't want to approach people that I know because they're just going to tell me something rather than actually respond to the questions. And I'm just looking for folks. And it's so much effort to develop a sample of people. And one of the problems with developing them through a place like a retirement community or a senior organization, like right now I have a kind of an in with the Older Women's League in Lawrence. Well, the Older Women's League are politically active people who have a certain take and point of view on things, and sometimes you're wary of seeing them. And we're always looking for diversity. You're always looking for diverse populations, too. Looking for rural populations, looking for urban populations, and they're sometimes hard to access unless one has an in.
Well, for us, I mean, that's why outreach is one of our focuses, and that's one of my responsibilities is to go out to talk to people. It's a recruiting opportunity, and you're looking at you really work like what are the partnerships that would be symbiotic, churches, community centers, as well as businesses, agencies, social service agencies. I mean, it's kind of a lot of them. But I think it's just you got to do the work of building the relationship.
So what else would enable an expansion of research? What do people need other than federal funding, which isn't going to perk up anytime soon?
I was just going to say, I would love to have ideas from people who work at teaching universities on how you make it work. It's like for someone who does 4 classes a semester, it's a challenge. And so it would be really nice to be able to talk with people like that and figure out how you make scholarship work in a way that doesn't dig you an early grade.
I don't think I have an answer.
Yeah, but I mean, seriously, if teaching universities could get together, I think that I hope. I mean, if there's others in the room, I think that a conversation might be
have a subcommittee that talks about research and thinks of research ideas and then sees, you know, tries to decide if they're implementable or not. But sometimes there's a gap, you know, where we don't have somebody that has a certain knowledge or expertise base, and then we need to find that scholar or that researcher. So being able to access something that says, you know, like a database of you all, you know, that says here is Dave Eckert's areas of expertise and interest and so on and so forth would be a great help to us.
I think this day and a half has been very fruitful along those lines. Keep seeing all sorts of little sidebar going on. Jay's asked me to review for his journal. Great, another journal to review for, right? But it's probably a real benefit to have some ideas in different areas of expertise. So here we, I think, have formed a nucleus of that, and sort of a nucleus on Dennis's website, and maybe we can to take it over and expand it.
I wonder if I could, not to just refer to me, to ask a question related to actually the databases and what databases tend to be made up of. I guess the units tend to be individuals with varieties of conditions, for example, stroke registry, cancer registry, all these kinds of things, or a variety of old people, I guess is what you're talking about, okay. And so on. But, you know, it's, and I think my guess is that most of you are working, would find in that vein, would find that useful. But I wonder if anybody is working in a different vein, which the unit isn't individual. I think there are registries of organizations, and you don't have to have a registry of that. That's available through associations and what have you. Phone books or online. But let's say you're, just to provoke some discussion that's in a different direction, suppose your unit of analysis is situations or events. And so how, you know, which are not individual specific. For example, there may be encounters of certain kinds that you're interested in, professional, non-professional encounters, street encounters, and so forth, that are pre-diagnostic. That may lead eventually to an illness or what have you. But you know what happens, which is well known in the areas I study in. The primary diagnosis is not done by the physician, the professional. They're done by families on the street. They're done all kinds of places. That is the decision on whether you call your so-called condition to the attention of a professional who will then diagnose. It doesn't have to be a physician. It could be someone else. Physical therapist. Is engaged in diagnostics. So there is folk diagnosis. It's an important area of study, and I think probably for many of us, related to aging experiences, because aging people have a lot of illnesses. But there are things that happen before they encounter formal diagnostic procedures. And so the issue is how do you get at that? All my students are engaged in that kind of interest. Which is an important interest, and is not anti-professional. I think that's a mistake to think of it this way. It's of interest to professionals. How is it that you got here? And how do people get to me? Not to get to me personally, but get to the pathway, the meeting, you know, that kind of thing. And so it's I'm not asking for a solution. I'm just saying that there may be people we're working with, students, projects that we're working on that engage us that way. That's one area that I'm interested in. Another area that may be closer to your interest is a lot of our students do textual analysis. And I don't mean formal texts like novels, films, and so forth. They analyze medical records. Not like medical records people analyze records. That's okay. That's a proper procedure, but it's not that kind of thing. It might be discursive analysis of records. It might even involve a simple matter of word counts. But content and analysis in the broadest sense, okay, which may be word counts, it may be theme counts, it's a little fuzzy when it's theme counts, and so forth. And I think a lot of people are doing that kind of thing. In sociology, natural anthropology, and I think in psychology as well. Both sorts of things. So, you know, just to raise the issue, there are those two kinds of units of analysis that are, you know, important to consider, I think, in teaching. And some of this is a difficulty for me because I'm very comfortable with situational context as unit of analysis because I'm an ethnographer. But I'm not as comfortable with textual analysis. Okay, although I like that. And I combine the two. And just let me add one other thing to complicate matters. These things are embedded in each other. So you have text embedded in organizations, embedded in situations. It's a nightmare at times. And you know, by the way, other people do films besides interested parties. For example, in certain kinds of therapy, they're filming in order to teach other therapists how to do therapy. That kind of thing, which is fascinating. Because there's an intertextuality there. You know, they're talking about the patient in one room, and they call sometimes the therapist in the other room to tell them what to do at that point in the therapeutic process. But it's complicated. Okay, I just want to raise it as an issue. Not asking for solutions, but suppose you have a student like that comes to you and say, I want to study.
I think this is another place where the website and the sort of the ask an expert kind of component of it could help. I know a colleague who has remarkable skills at getting access to work in assisted living centers, and has identified a network, a set of procedures, a set of steps, sort of checkbacks for that. Well, being able to bottle her experience to help others who want to work in assisted living centers, doing training and intervention programs. What are the challenges of doing video recording in such a facility? Christine's really understands not just the challenges, but the solution to that. And some of these other kinds of things they ask an expert. I have access to this kind of set of reminiscences, or what do I do with them, or would they be of interest, right? Or I want to collect a set of autobiographical recalls, right. and anybody have any experience doing that? And so I think that could really be part of what could be this kind of ask an expert component of the consortium.
And Susan, do you think that they could ever do like webinars, perhaps?
Yeah.
Because I'd love to hear her talk about how she developed
but
that.
So if we get this webinar component working, right? Either a periodic one or a scheduled one. Bringing in people talking about that, providing examples, some of the challenges, tips, and techniques. I think that could be a second stage, a growth of that. Right.
Yeah, I just to give you a sense of the places that some of my students have done field work. Some have done field work, for example, with elderly prisoners in prison. Some with elderly persons on the street doing various things. Some working in the drug trade, some aren't. That's a job. Or just living there, in the mall, that kind of thing. It's a little bit difficult putting that on the web. Because it borders the legal and the illegal.
Yes, those are a lot of the challenges.
But one of the interesting things is the border is the most interesting thing. That's the interesting thing. How do you maintain a living without getting, mugged for one thing, or getting busted for another thing? So the border work involved is fascinating in terms of where you turn out, or what you turn out to be, a medical statistic or a non-medical statistic. It might be a prison statistic. You know, so, you know, the generation of the, you know, first line of official statistics is something that's an important question. The first line, not the second line, which we access pretty easily. Yeah, so that means that kind of thing. So I think I like the idea of people who are working in particular areas listed, mm-hmm. and a very general sense of the kinds of fields they've studied. Fields in a theoretical sense, mm-hmm. not the disciplinary sense, mm-hmm. you know, street corners, whatever, slums. Slums is a bad word now.
Mexican restaurants,
which one of my students is investigating, and so forth.
Well, I can imagine you talking about situations, research on, for example, political action.
Yes.
And political action happens once in a while here and there, and you need to know that it's going on. And how would you, could you talk to AA, does AARP let you do research? Can you come around there very hard?
Very, very hard.
I would bet they're a little troublesome.
Well, yeah. you know, they can't have a registry of political events because they're happenstance.
Right.
But so, you know, you have to have other means of getting it.
How do you get close to these? I mean, what organizations would allow you if you had, I know the Older Women's League in my town. Why don't you see if you could call the Older Women's League in your town and see if they're about to show up with placards protesting this, that, or the other.
Protest events.
You know, there was an opportunity in the sign-up for, was there research on the sign-up for Medicare Part D? Now we're going 10 years ago. Was there research, extensive research on that? It was supposed to have been horrible. It was going to be horrible. It was going to be that, you know, it was going to be a train wreck. And we all seem to be used to it now. I don't know, it was an enormous social experiment.
Nancy Pelosi talking about it on NPR because she was defending the current.
Well, yes, there is a relevance these days.
Right, so she was saying that there actually were a lot of problems with it. They must have known that by doing some kind of data counting to figure out what the problems with that were.
But again, having the opportunity to ask people how do I get into assisted living? How do I approach a political organization? Can I even ask AARP? Are there any considerations? Veterans organizations are another place to find older people. They're not all old at veterans organizations like the VFW, but they're a potential great source for research participants. But what does it take to approach a VFW post? I mean, whose permission do you have to ask? What are the techniques?
Well, one of my students studied VFW bar, post bar.
So did we, but in a more practical sense.
Yeah, I mean, so it was just a matter. And he compared that to other kinds of taverns, because he's interested in drinking cultures. Mm-hmm. So fraternity bar, VFW bar, which is politically really quite different. And something else. Okay, so he did a study then. And then I want to bring the issue of IRB in here, because we have no trouble getting IRB permission, but you're not supposed to do your research before IRB to get the permission. I guess you're allowed to do feeling around a little bit. I don't know. You probably shouldn't do anything. But the problem is, take a protest event. In order to know when that's going to happen, you know, I have to know the network of participants, you know, and to sort of get an idea when something might likely blow up. So that takes a certain acquaintance.
Yeah.
You know, this IRB sense of the timetable of research, of course, we know is crazy, but you just deal with it. But there is this problem too, it's very helpful to be an insider to study certain kinds of events that are not too predictable. And so that kind of thing, I think, is helpful to have somebody who's, you know, a source of knowledge of somebody who's tried to teach that, or have access to that. And it might be one of your students, Ms. Susan, or one of your students in psych, and because they're interested in the psychology of these kinds of events. And I'd be happy to tell you what my experience is with studying that sort of thing.
But I think that's the idea of maybe trying to develop this sort of webinar series of an expert advice and guidance on on a variety of different kinds of topics, how to deal with IRB issues, how to get access to sites, how to how
I
analyze X, right?
I have a question about IRB that I'd like some comparative information about. You know, we all
ours is worse. ours is worse.
Ours is gone worse.
I've heard worse, though.
Don't go over to the healthcare side, though.
No.
Yeah, we have two different IRBs. We have a health IRB,
yeah,
and we have a campus IRB.
And then there's the online training and compliance. Let's not go there.
It took me 15 hours to get recertified.
I thought I did all of mine, and now apparently
you had to redo it because they did a new system. So
don't do it in the wrong system.
I have to do it for the campus IRB. But the campus IRB, for some reason, we had problems with somebody that was director of IRB, the campus one, for many, many years, let's say stretching back 10 years ago. To the point where this person was obstructing all kinds of research.
She was
fired.
That was the old thing.
That's actually very true.
Yeah, she was fired. Things started getting easier. Okay? And one of the nice things about observational research, they think, oh, that's not intervention. You're just watching things. So I have no problem at all getting IRB. In fact, my student who submitted the Mexican restaurant dessert 2 days ago, submitted and got okay yesterday.
Well,
overnight.
Nice.
It's example.
So Mexican restaurants are okay.
Well,
maybe I should change the focus of my research.
The interesting thing about studying the field is there's a hell of a lot of stuff going on. It's very sensitive material. You don't know about it.
Yeah.
But
as long as it doesn't involve health information.
So.
No, it could involve illegal behaviors.
That would probably be bad too.
Yeah.
Well, IRB doesn't care about that. Unless it's explicitly you're studying money laundering. If you're explicitly doing that, then it becomes an illegal issue. Because you're studying just the restaurant, which it might occur.
You were going to say something a while back, weren't you?
I just remembered. I think we have another group across the hall. They might have some ideas for research that we're not thinking.
Yeah.
I mean, we're all talking about stuff we're interested in, which is great. But let's face it, in an environment where the federal government's not going to pay us to really do things we find interesting anymore, we need to start thinking about who will pay us to do things that are research-related. And I would like for us to consider how we would approach research from a standpoint of working with folks that might have different agendas, different time frames, different measures of success than we do in academic environments. I think we have to realize that as scientists and academics, our standards for what truth is and what's important may carry with it time frames that will not be the kinds of time frames that will be responsive to the needs of some partners we've been talking with, nor problems that we're interested in might not be the kinds of problems that we're interested in. And if we want to keep doing this, we might want to change our thinking a little bit, or be open to other models as well.
Well, I'm hopeful that this kind of registry could serve both needs, and this kind of website could serve both sets of needs.
That was abstract, Paul. Can you give an example?
I'll give you an example.
Yeah.
Let's say that I want to do research in distracted driving, and I want to go ahead and go into my laboratory and use my driving simulator and find out how the brain works. That's great. And I can publish that, and I can talk about it, and that's fantastic. At the same time, I've got three automobile manufacturers that are putting 17-inch electronic displays in vehicles that are going to kill people, right? And they're jumping way ahead of us, and they've got a lot more money, and they can push an agenda. And I'll be continuously trying to catch up with what they're doing, right? That's not a way to do science anymore. Right? If you want it to have an impact, I think what you need to realize is there might be some other folks out there that might have an interest in saying, you know, here's some safety devices we should be thinking about. Why would that safety device be useful or not useful? And maybe you could partner with them to do that kind of research. Or there might be an organization like the National Safety Council that I work with who might say, you know, here are some problems that we should look at. Or AAA, who funded Dave Strayer's research to go out for $1.5 million and build a car and actually look at whether or not a device detects in a vehicle is actually safe or not. It's not. You know, so, you know, with the AAA research is a good example. You know, they wanted Dave Strayer to do some really careful research, but at the same time, they had certain demands. He had to do research that could be sold to the public. He had to do research that could help with the safety agenda. He had to do research that would make sense to the average consumer. And I think if they're trying to work with folks that might be in the silver industries that were listed, you know, financial industries, home care, these other kinds of things, the sorts of academic questions that we have, while they may be interesting to us and are certainly important, need to be modified in ways that someone sitting over there, for example, might be willing to pay us to ask them. But what it takes, I will just say, having done this for a few years now, is it takes thinking a bit differently. You have to think in terms of getting outcomes that will probably be faster than you're comfortable with. You won't know the answer from an academic standpoint where you're 95% sure that global warming's happening and it's caused by man, right? You may have to be willing to infer and move beyond the data a little bit more than you're comfortable with. You may have to realize that what you're doing ultimately might have a financial motivation behind it for somebody because they're paying you.
This sounds like another webinar, Paul.
It might be. I do think that there's value in expanding the models of what we think has value and how we can co-opt that for our own agenda.
Well, with the chat, and I'm going to totally direct it to you, put you on the spot. But I guess I'm curious of what would be helpful as the concept of this research network versus you doing that on your own or within your university? Is there any?
Well, I'm
struggling with thinking through that right now.
What are
advantages here versus?
What do we have that we can sell?
Why do you have to sell it?
Well, just hold on.
Why does it have to be funded? Those are two restrictions you're putting on something that is not always the case.
I guess we could ask by a show of hands who's interested in funding for their work, and I think there would be who's interested in getting funding for their work.
I can't do mine without funding.
Yeah. Okay, so that's the answer.
I'm not interested in some cases for funding because funding comes with strings attached.
It does.
Just like you're talking.
So
there is permission for doing that.
For those people that are interested, and I think that was a super majority of you, I think that's an important question. I think what do we have to sell? We have our intellectual talent. We have a lot of intellectual talent, and we have that comes with the methodological talent, the rigor to, when a question is asked, be able to come with an answer that is based in data, as opposed to based in marketing, which I think is very important. And as Susan was talking about, and everyone else is talking about, we have a population. You have a group of people, you know, with these databases that I know that people would love to have access to market to, but they would also love to have access to find out what they need, what they want, what they're capable of. So that's what we have. What else do we have?
Well, I have an example. Something that I've been involved in. There's this new generation of internet capability that is rolling out. It is part of federal government initiatives. And there's a partnership of businesses and researchers called US Ignite. And they are, I attended their symposium in June, it was in Chicago. They have frequently met in Kansas, actually. They will continue to meet and generate ideas about how we can use this next generation of internet. And we're very interested in really looking at highlighting how to use it for education, how to use it for health, and how to use it for safety and building communities. When I attend, there's a lot of people, obviously, businesses who are technology savvy, who can use the internet in a variety of ways. Developing products that will use the internet or need to use the internet. And some of the things that they're talking about
developing need people who know people.
Right.
To say, yeah, that's a good idea, or wait a minute, have you thought about how you're going to be compromising this person's privacy?
Exactly.
And I use that example because when we look at the third generation of internet, that is across this country. So while I can address it from the state of Missouri and Columbia, Missouri, Manhattan may be a very, very different area because then you're moving into more rural, different geographical challenges, different connectivity challenges, different geographical culture. And that's just a perfect example of something that's going on right now, and they paid me to go to this thing.
If we don't get at, here's, and that's a great illustration, because if we can't get at the table, they will build it, whatever it is, because that's what engineers do, and that's what businesses want, to build stuff, to make products. And they won't necessarily think about the kinds of things that we would think about in terms of how useful that might be, how it might impact privacy, how it might impact community. I think we have to recognize that we bring a lot, but we have to get to the table. And getting to the table means, in some cases, you have to be able to have a conversation that's of value to the people that are at the table. I know, you know, Cheryl, you talked about this in terms of the New Cities Initiative. What really attracted me working with Dennis on that was this idea of using technology in new cities to really bring older adults in connection with their families who might be at remote. And, but there are a number of questions about some of the things you brought up that need to be answered. But if we don't get to the table during that building process, then what happens is it will just get built. And then we'll have to try to figure out after the fact if that was a good idea.
Well, we're not all building things. But what do you mean getting to the table?
What I mean about getting to the table is if we're building a community here, a community for intergenerational living here in Lawrence, Kansas, there's someone who's bought a bunch of ground and there's a developer that will build the buildings and there are people that will put in the technology infrastructure. That will be done. Regardless of whether or not I, as a person who knows about technology, or Susan, as a person who knows about aging, is involved or not, it will get done. It will be much more productive, I think, if we're at that discussion at the beginning, like we are now, where we can have both an impact on how it's done, as well as potential research questions that could be asked, and to actually get at the table.
Well, there are other kinds of tables. Another kind of table.
Yes, I recognize that, but I'm just talking
about this. There are other kinds of tables, and one kind of table is someone that may know something about this whole community of in this built environment kind of situation, and studies it well, and knows that it operates by rules that are not very evident, and then publishes a book on that and explodes the whole thing. Now that's a table. It's a
and
table.
That's one mechanism.
That's
what mechanism is available to
exactly.
us. But the conversation I think Paul was having was, and not to defend it, but one of the things that I think is part of this is not so much, there's lots of ways to have your voice.
Exactly.
And I think this conversation about research is a way of finding as many voices as possible. And
there's lots of ways of doing
research.
Yeah,
that's right.
Lots of scales, lot.
It is true that we hear, when we talk to people like Rebecca, as an example, who's no longer with us, but when we talk to people like Rebecca, whose expertise is in helping us go after funding, which is important for my particular line of work, the point is that we have to be able to start translating our language a little differently in that particular conversation. And in a way, actually publishing books is another great example of this. You can publish a number of different kinds of books, and the kind of impact that you would have depends on the language and the audience that you're envisioning when you write that book. And I just think that's part of it. I mean, one of the things that I've been going after that I think is fruitful, it's a different conversation, is talking with not-for-profits. We've had money from Templeton Foundation for some of our research. We just received a grant from the Sunflower Foundation to fund some of our research, which I think could definitely translate into a project with New Cities that has to do about getting out in the nature. And we've already talked to Dennis about it. And exactly, making sure those trails are part of it, because we provide data to suggest that those trails not only have a physiological benefit and a physical benefit, but they also have a benefit cognitively. So those are the kinds of conversations I think that are...
I don't want you to get the impression I'm undervaluing what we do. I'm the last person that we do. I think that what we do in the university environment has incredible potential. I think that American higher education is really our probably best gift to the world, honestly, more than anything. Our best gift to the world. Our model of higher education, I think, probably represents... But what I want to suggest, though, is that as we're thinking about research, that we expand our map to include other things. That's all I'm saying.
I think that was the whole point of this little GabFest, this little get-together, is to expand...
There's lots of possibilities.
And we've had, I think, a wonderful, productive session coming up with some possibilities. I suspect the people in the other room have come up with even more possibilities, and hopefully we'll have a little time to hear about how they might fit together and complement one another and really strengthen one another. And it's all about a variety of different possibilities across all of these different perspectives, not different disciplines that are represented, different approaches, and different institutions.
Something I was doing.
Along these lines, I want to say something about that, because I've been very quiet here all morning, and my background is in architecture, and we haven't talked about architecture at all, and I know that's not really the focus necessarily, but I want to bring it to your attention and maybe ask the question how you might see architecture having played a role in what you do, and what could architecture bring to your work that you haven't thought about.
Yeah.
Certainly I know that as a teacher of architecture, your work is of great interest to me and my students, and we can use that in the design of certain kinds of environments, but you know, we spend so much time in architecture, we're always in architecture, and so does it matter in your work? So I'm interested in hearing more about that, in exploring ways of collaboration.
I'm a big Ed Powell Long fan, and he developed a paradigm of, you know, create the best optimal environment that challenges a person, but not too much so that they feel defeated. And I see architecture as being a big part of that in creating healthy environments for people to thrive and grow. And I actually used a lot of researches in architecture to craft my dissertation. And I'm currently working with an architectural studies student who is looking at mental health environments in residential care. And she asked me to join her dissertation committee for the theoretical perspective of it. So I see that there are wonderful ways that you can connect in.
Can I respond to that a little bit? I find that this environmental thing component is extremely important. Because it tends to turn our attention to more material kinds of things and not just behavioral. So that the material constraints, if you want to put it that way, the material opportunities for doing certain kinds of things really is an architectural concern. Now, the kinds of opportunities you might have might not be healthy ones. Okay? That is, they're making an investment in unhealthy kinds of things because it brings in money. And therefore, it's important to take a critical attitude toward the built environment, whether that's a nursing home, whether it's a school for ADHD kids, or what have you. So these kinds of issues is kind of what I'm getting at. Right? That is, getting away a little bit, not getting away from, but trying to explore the limits of the kinds of technologies, data gathering technologies we have, that allow us to get at those sorts of things. Okay? Sensors are not going to work in those kinds of environments. You know, because they're not sensing the kinds of things you're interested in. There are people in certain communities that don't want things changed at all in terms of built environments, and don't even want to talk about it because something is going on there that is very useful to them, you know, but not useful to anybody else in that environment. So what do you do with that? You know, the politics of a built environment. Now, I don't mean to say the politics of builders in a built environment, the politics of livers in a built environment.
And that delivers
too.
All the
it's given what you
want. Well, see, I think this is this is sort of one of the things that I've got now going to Dennis's think tank, right? Is it, because it seems to have been, at least in my education and experience, very compartmentalized. And, but there seems to be a lot going on that I think leads to very interesting questions about facilitating social engagement, facilitating cognitive engagement, facilitating physical engagement, and how to do that. And we need more examples and that I think you have that kind of work. Of language, of spaces,
right? We need that. And that is the truth. I mean, it's the vocabulary and the credentials that make this whole thing also different. And we don't.
So we're so used to what is and not what could be, right? Or alternative.
I just want to add, when you push down, supporting him in research and building environment. I'm doing research on healthcare environment. Whatever the research I'm doing now, whatever the outcome I will have now for our literature, is going to be implemented for 5 years. So, and once the building will be constructed, it's millions of dollars of building possibilities. So, I'm kind of like supporting him. If we are doing the research, the built environment research with the industry, collaborating with the construction project is going on, it's not only giving us the funding, but also enhancing us, like advancing us like 5 to 10 years more. So that's, I feel, that's the gap between architecture and research. Again, am I clear here? Like, I'm doing the research, my outcome will be published in a book within 3 years. And that's going to distribute in the world next 3 years, and then the building coding is going to be changed, and then the building is going to make, it's like a 10 years, and by the time the research outcome is different. So it's better to start working from now, whether like hospitals or hospital, whatever is going on. So yeah, definitely the research, I think.
One thing for me, I'd like to, I don't know, we're running it, I know we're moving into lunch now, but maybe future discussions. I'd like to talk or think through more, the cross-discipline discussion is important, but I could have a lot of that discussion within my university as well. I'd really like to think about cross-university, and particularly regionally. You know, I know that there, in some of our schools that aren't on the aging bandwagon or the gerontology background, our schools and departments, I'd like to, if there's a more formal way to reach out to some regional universities that maybe that department or school or architecture has more strengths in that area, and how can we more formally do that versus me individually just calling someone up?
There are certainly more site potential nodes on the I-70 network than we included.
Well, or just already in our current routines here, I mean, we have, obviously within St. Louis, I mean, there can be more opportunities of cross university collaborations, but I'd like to be able to even go to national conferences and be like, I'm working in the city, and it's not a surprise when I go to a national conference and hear like XYZ is happening in Kansas City or XYZ is happening in Topeka or Lawrence, and they're like, all right, can you just be 2 hours away from each other, even in the same state. So if there's ways that maybe this idea of this network could kind of foster that a little bit more, it would be nice.
Get to learn about the different models that are out there. Because I know like there's legislative acts that happen sometimes that create opportunities for us. Because I was working on a project in Michigan years ago because the nursing homes in Michigan couldn't expand their Medicaid beds unless they were doing evaluation, and so they had to reach out to universities to help them with their evaluation. And they were providing the money for universities to come in and do that. And so if there's other kinds of acts like that happening, in states that affect us, it'd be interesting to know about them and to be able to piggyback our efforts.
Well, we're being invaded. Can I try a summary? We are going to summarize at the end of lunch here. But I, from this morning's meeting, at least, there's support for a sort of methods of teaching that each of us are doing at our independent places. Mm-hmm. There could potentially be support if it could be I mean, commitment. There could be potential commitment if we could find monetary support for a summer institute. We're finding a design for a rotating or a roving summer institute that would be a benefit at some educational level. There's other benefits, by the way. We've heard about all these teaching methods, sites, GEROE, and so on and so forth. And finally, some sort of web affordance for sharing research resources, such as participant registries, such as particular methodological expertise in this technique or that technique, or this situation or that situation, or even approaches to organizations within our communities or within our region that might be amenable to research. Okay, thank you.